Hello again. Al Ford is with us here at Proactive Investor Studio in London from Mining Capital. Al, as always, great to see you. And big news to talk about today, this merger between Randgold and Barrick Gold. What does it mean?
Well, it's come as a bit of a surprise to the markets, this merger, an $18 billion merger between London's largest gold mining company and one of the largest gold mining companies from North America. It's a deal that's been received with mixed reception, really, from analysts and investors. On the whole, I think broadly positive. There are going to be significant savings generated by both companies, significant economies of scale. The geographical spreads of both companies will obviously be greater, with Randgold's operations in Africa now complemented by some serious North American presence. But the London contingent of investors will no longer have a local listing to support because Randgold and Barrick have signaled that they will cancel the London listing. So that will leave the London market empty of any major gold miner to invest in, and will probably open up a bit of a void, actually, and there'll be some interesting activity to see in terms of who will fill that gap and where investors will put their money.
And Acacia, of course, another component to this decision that people are adjusting to. They were part of Barrick Gold. What happens to them? What are the implications
there? So Acacia is one of the London companies that will be left in a more prominent position with the departure of Randgold. But the order of magnitude in terms of market capitalization is a great deal smaller, probably about a tenth of the size, roughly speaking. Acacia, as we know, used to be owned by Barrick and was spun out, but Barrick retained a 44% ownership of Acacia, so they're still very much a leading player in terms of what Acacia says and does. And today Acacia put out what they call a holding statement, and they're saying they're going to have discussions with Barrick and obviously with the enlarged group to see what happens in that regard. But it wouldn't surprise me if down the line, Mark Bristow, the CEO of Randgold, who is now going to move into the chief executive's position in the larger company, actually just rolls up that position and re-merges Acacia back into the larger company, because Bristow himself is an expert in African gold mining, and it just wouldn't really seem to make any sense to leave that Acacia stake just standing alone out there without bringing it in-house to benefit.
Still quite a lot of I's to dot and T's to cross, aren't there? What happens, for example, to those interests held by investors in Barrick Gold? What does their value now translate as on the market?
Well, the Barrick proportion of the company will amount to about 66% approximately, and Randgold shareholders will get about a third, 33%. This deal was done largely at market. They did a weighted average of share prices over the last 20 trading days, I think. And the Barrick share price and the Randgold share price too has not been, that neither of them been stellar performers over the last year or so, or perhaps even longer, because the gold price has been weak. And what's perhaps more significant is there is an expectation in the market that the gold price will continue to be weak down the line. So one reason for this merger is to deliver those economies of scale and to provide a certain strong defensive position in the gold mining
industry. So in some respects then it's a kind of a reaction to the climate within the gold industry itself?
Well, it could be viewed that way. I mean, the bulls in the market will say, well, this may signal a new round of M&A activity in the mining sector, and there hasn't really been much in the way of big deals over the last few years, actually, and this is probably one of the bigger ones that we've seen. But the bears will say, no, this is the gold mining industry taking a little bit of a negative view and actually retreating into itself a little bit, defensive deals to cope with possible adverse conditions ahead. And I think actually it remains to be seen. I mean, the wider investment community expects the gold price to be pressured because the US Federal Reserve is going to raise interest rates probably more than once over the next 12 months. And that makes gold as a commodity less attractive to hold. And obviously, therefore, it would be less profitable to sell for the major gold miners. But that's all up for grabs. And if it doesn't pan out that way, if the gold price does go up, then we could see a renewed vigor in the enlarged Barrick and Randgold group. And in the wider gold mining industry too.
And what's your sense on that then, as far as M&As are concerned? I mean, some people are calling September merger month. Is that realistic?
Well, we had quite a quiet summer, as we often do, and the activity usually picks up in September to some degree in terms of news flow. Lately, it's been more at the end of August, and I think that at the moment the market is still quite mixed. The outlook in Canada is a bit more muted. The London market's alive and kicking, but not really roaring away. And in Australia, actually, which hasn't really figured in this particular deal, but there's a significant gold mining industry in Australia. Some of the world's biggest gold mining companies are based there, and actually that's the strongest area of the market at the moment in terms of the global mining industry. So we may see the Australians looking over at this deal and thinking, well, I wonder what opportunities this presents for us.
Al Ford, thanks very much indeed.
Thank you, Polly.